In the last lesson, we went over the transformations that can be applied to sine and cosine functions, and we built an understanding of why those transformations affect the graphs the way they do. And I definitely recommend you check out that lesson if you haven't already. I'll leave a link in the description. That should prepare you for this lesson. And in this lesson, we're going to do some real nitty-gritty, dirty examples of graphing transformations of sine and cosine functions. This is a sort of outline of the method that I recommend that we'll use in this video, but I definitely recommend that you do what works for you. So we'll work through these examples by first finding the midline, which is y equals d if our functions are written in this form. Then we find the amplitude, which is a if our functions are in this form. Then we find the phase shift, which is negative c if our functions are written in this form. I'll stop saying that, you get the point. And then the period, which is 2 pi over b, and then the quarter periods. The importance of the quarter periods, if you didn't take my advice and watch the previous lesson, because we talked about them in the previous lesson, but the importance of the quarter periods is that the key points of a period of a sine and cosine function, so the point where it starts at the midline, then it goes up to its peak, and then it comes back to the midline, goes down to its lowest point, and then comes back to the midline, completing the period, these key points are a quarter period apart. So the distance from here to here is one quarter period, and then the distance from here to here on the x-axis is one quarter period, distance from here to here on the x-axis is one quarter period, and so on. So those quarter periods really help us label our x-axis. And the y-axis we are able to label after we find the midline and amplitude. There are certainly some hidden steps in here that you've got to make sure you don't forget, so it's not a complete list of instructions. So let's see those fine details work out as we get into some examples. So we're starting off with a graph of a sine function. And if you are in school, your teachers might want you to label your x and y axes and maybe even add arrowheads at the front and the back, but that gets my screen too cluttered, so I object and I don't do it. We're bad boys here at Wrath of Math, so, you know, tread carefully. All right, let's get on to our example, this sine function. We begin trying to find our midline. We see there's no addition or subtraction of any number at the end of our function, so our midline is the one we're most familiar with, y equals 0. And now, what about the amplitude, which we will call a? Well, you might say, look at that, it's 2 in front of the sine function, the amplitude is 2. But there is a sort of hidden step here that wasn't explicitly listed in the instructions. Notice that the coefficient of x is negative. We don't really like that. We would like to sort of change how things are written here without changing the function so that x has a positive coefficient. We need to do that at this step because that will affect the amplitude in a sine function. So how do we get rid of that negative coefficient of x? Well, again, I'll mention, if you watched the previous video, you probably already have some idea. First, inside the sine function, we'll factor out a negative 1. So that leaves us with negative 1 times x plus pi. Next, we just need to remember that sine is an odd function, which again we talked about in the last lesson. That means that sine of some negative stuff is equal to negative sine of that stuff. So effectively, we can bring our negative 1 outside of the sine function and bring it out in front. So we would have negative 2 sine of x plus pi. All right, now we have rewritten our function in an equivalent form that we're more comfortable with. There we are. So now we see our amplitude is actually negative 2, which is going to affect how we draw the graph. Now that we've completed the first two steps, we've got our midline and our amplitude, we can start to label the y-axis. We need to mark the points on the y-axis that are 2 above our midline and 2 below our midline. Since our midline is y equals 0, those points are simply 2 and negative 2, since our amplitude is negative 2. These labels would, of course, be the same if the amplitude was positive 2, but the amplitude being negative is going to affect how the graph is drawn. Then we want to find our phase shift. Since x has a coefficient of 1, we can immediately see that our phase shift is going to be negative pi. In general, we can always find the phase shift by setting the stuff inside the sine function, in this case that's x plus pi, set that equal to 0, we see that x is equal to negative pi. This means that sine of 0, where we would like our period to start, sine of 0 occurs at x equals minus pi. So that is our phase shift, and then we just need to find our period, which we'll call p. Since the coefficient in front of x is 1, the period is 2 pi divided by 1, which of course is 2 pi. So we'll write that over there with p, and then we just need to find our quarter periods, which we'll call q. Of course, a quarter period is a quarter of the period, which is 2 pi over 4, which is equal to pi over 2. All right, beautiful. We've got all of our information, and now we can go ahead and sketch the graph, which will begin with labeling our x-axis. The first mark we want to make on the x-axis is where our period will start, which is given by the phase shift. In this case, that's negative pi. So you might just drop a mark anywhere you please. That's x equals negative pi. However, we have to take care to note that putting this mark here implicitly gives some scale to the x-axis. And what do I mean by that? Well, the next point we would want to mark on this x-axis is a quarter period away from negative pi. So we would find that point by adding pi over 2 to our phase shift, negative pi, which gives us negative pi over 2. Now, negative pi over 2, of course, is halfway between x equals 0 and negative pi. So the next point I would want to mark a quarter period away from our phase shift would be right about there. So by putting negative pi there on the x-axis, we've made it so that a quarter period is about that long. Personally, I would like more room to draw a period of this graph. So for me, that scale is a bit small. For you, that might be just what you want, but just be aware of that. If you want your graph to be to scale, you've got to be a bit careful about where you put your phase shift, because that affects the scale of the axis. So I'm going to erase that and put our phase shift a little bit further out, say, right there. By putting the phase shift there, our quarter period, which in this case is pi over 2, is about that long, and that's a length I'm comfortable with. And alright, it's pretty straightforward from here. The x-coordinate of our next key point, we already found that, that's negative pi over 2. To find the x-coordinate of the next key point, we add another quarter period to this one, which gets us to 0, because negative pi over 2 plus pi over 2 is 0. Then we need to do that two more times, so add a quarter period to 0, that's easy enough, that's pi over 2. And then add a quarter period to that, pi over 2 plus pi over 2 is pi. Then we can go ahead and plot our points and sketch the graph. Our phase shift is negative pi, so that's where our period starts, and it's a sine function, so our period starts at the midline. Then, typically, the next key point would be up here at the peak of the function. However, since our amplitude is negative, all of these points that would normally be above the x-axis get flipped, so they are below the x-axis. So the next key point is actually at negative pi over 2, negative 2. And then it comes back up to 0, and then it goes to its peak at 2, and then it comes back to the midline, completing the period. And so this period of our function looks something like this. Beautiful. And of course, you could sketch some more of it by hand if you wanted to, or you could be a little pickier and find some more key points to sketch more of the graph. But I definitely think once you've done one period, it's pretty smooth sailing if you want to do another one. Alright, next example, we've got another sine function. I'm going to move this up and to the right a little bit and draw the axes. And now before I draw my x-axis, the first thing I notice is that we have a vertical shift of negative 2. So since we have a shift of negative 2, and I also see that our amplitude isn't being changed, I know that our graph is going to be in the third and fourth quadrants, since it's getting moved down. So I'm going to draw the x-axis pretty high. That gives us lots of room down here in the third and fourth quadrants. Alright, first thing to do is identify the midline. We already kind of did that. That's y equals negative 2. And when the midline isn't y equals 0, not a bad idea to put it on the graph. So that's what we'll do. We'll say this right here is negative 2. And I'll go ahead and draw a dotted line at y equals negative 2. Alright, so there's our midline at y equals negative 2. Next, the amplitude, again we already kind of pointed that out, is 1, which is a typical amplitude for a sine and cosine function. You should have taken note that x currently has a coefficient of positive 1, so we don't have to mess around with any negatives. Now that we've got the midline and amplitude, we can label the y-axis some more. Since the amplitude is 1, we want to mark 1 unit above the midline and 1 unit below the midline. So that's going to be negative 1 there and negative 3 there. 1 unit above and 1 unit below. Now we want to find the phase shift. Since x has a coefficient of 1, we can see immediately the phase shift is negative pi over 2. If this 4 was not factored out of this expression, so we would have 4x plus 2 pi, then to find the phase shift, we would either have to set this equal to 0 and solve for x, or factor out the 4, which would give us what is currently written inside the function, which lets us immediately pick out that phase shift. Again, if you don't understand why that is, go check out the previous lesson. Or you could just work out some examples yourself to see how it works. In any event, negative pi over 2 is our phase shift, and then we just need to find our period and quarter periods. The period is 2 pi divided by 4. So 2 pi over 4, that is pi over 2. And then the quarter period Q is just the period, pi over 2, divided by 4, which is pi over 8. And remember that finding the period is pretty straightforward. It's just 2 pi divided by either the number that is going to be multiplied by x, or when the number is not factored out, you're just dividing by the number that is being multiplied by x. Alright, so with all this information, we can start to label the x-axis. First, the phase shift of negative pi over 2. I immediately notice that the absolute value of this phase shift, which is pi over 2, is the same as the period, pi over 2. Which means wherever we start the phase shift, say right over there, this distance will be the distance of our period. So I'm going to put the phase shift just a little further back to give us some more room, say right there. That's negative pi over 2. And let's actually move that up to the x-axis. It's convenient to label the midline, but really, if at all possible, they should be on the x-axis. Then, to find the x-coordinate of the next key point, we just add a quarter period to the phase shift. So that's negative pi over 2 plus pi over 8. We can multiply negative pi over 2 by 4 over 4 in order to get a common denominator, so that's negative 4 pi over 8. Then we can see that that's going to leave us with negative 3 pi over 8. So we'll mark that down on the x-axis right about there. We know that our period is going to end at x equals 0. We can find that by adding the period to the phase shift. It's good to keep that in mind for our sense of scale, because our first key point after the phase shift should be about a fourth of the way between the phase shift and the end of the period. So good thing to keep that in mind to keep our graphs looking somewhat properly scaled. Alright, now to find the x-coordinate of our next key point, we just add pi over 8, a quarter period, to the previous key point, negative 3 pi over 8, and that's equal to negative 2 pi over 8. And we'll put that right about there on the x-axis. I'm actually going to move this negative 3 pi over 8 back just a little bit. We could reduce this fraction, negative 2 pi over 8, but I like to keep them unreduced until the end because it makes it easier to add the quarter periods to it. Find the x-coordinate of our next key point. We'll just add pi over 8 to negative 2 pi over 8, and that, of course, is negative pi over 8. And so that's going to be right about there. I'm going to go ahead and move this y-axis label to the other side just to make it a little less messy. Now, of course, if we add another quarter period, pi over 8, to negative pi over 8, we get 0. And so that's the x-coordinate of the end of our period. Alright, now we can go ahead and graph the points. This is a sine function, so here at the phase shift, it's going to start at the midline, y equals negative 2. Its amplitude is positive, so it's going to go up to its peak at negative 1 at the next key point. Then at the next key point, it comes back down to the midline, and then it goes down to its lowest point at negative 3. And then at the end of the period, it comes back to the midline. And there it is. That is our beautiful sine function with all those transformations. And again, of course, we could sketch another period if we wanted to. Something like that. Not too shabby. Lastly, you just might want to reduce your fractions. In this case, this is the only fraction we got to reduce. That's going to reduce down to negative pi over 4. And there we go. That's our sketch. Alright, next example. Here we've got a wonderful cosine function. Just noticing a couple things that influence how I draw the axes, we've got a plus 1 at the end of the function, which means it's going to be moved up 1 unit, and I can see that we're going to have a negative phase shift, but I don't know exactly what it is because of the form this function is written in. So I'm going to draw the x-axis a little bit low so that we have more room above the axis. Alright, step 1, we identify our midline, that's y equals 1. Then we want to identify the amplitude. Part of that process is making sure that the coefficient of x is positive. I see that it is, so we don't have to mess with anything. And in fact, in a cosine function, that's actually not going to affect the amplitude. But it does in a sine function, so it's good to get in the habit of doing it, and then when you've got a negative coefficient in your cosine function, you can get rid of that, even though it doesn't affect the amplitude. And remember, to get rid of a negative coefficient of x in the cosine function, you just have to multiply everything in the function by negative 1. Alright, so our amplitude is positive 1, what about our phase shift? Well, since x has a coefficient of 2, I can't just immediately pick out the phase shift from this function. So we could set the inside equal to 0, but I like to just factor out a 2, and then I can see my phase shift that way. So factoring out a 2, this is equal to cosine of 2 times x plus pi over 2, with that plus 1 at the end. So by factoring out a 2 here inside the function, I can see that my phase shift is going to be negative pi over 2. And let's go ahead and move that up. So the phase shift is negative pi over 2. Now what about the period p? Well, that's the standard period of a cosine function, 2 pi, divided by that number that's going to get multiplied by x. So that's 2 pi over 2, which is pi. Beautiful. And then, of course, our quarter period q, we can quite easily see, is pi over 4. Alright, for starters, we probably should have done this a couple steps ago. We'll draw the midline and mark the peaks and low points on the y-axis. The midline is y equals 1, we'll put that right there. Now I notice that the absolute value of the phase shift, pi over 2, that is double the quarter period, pi over 4. So if I put my phase shift right here, then halfway between this and x equals 0, that should be a quarter period. In this case, that's a distance I'm comfortable with. Alright, and I just realized I forgot to mark the peaks and low points on the y-axis, so the amplitude is 1. The midline is at y equals 1, so the peak will be 1 unit above the midline, at 2. And then the low point will be 1 unit below the midline, at y equals 0, which of course is down here at the x-axis. I'm going to move that 2 up just a little bit, say right about there. Alright, now we can mark up the x-axis. To find the x-coordinate of the next key point, we just add a quarter period to the phase shift. So that's negative pi over 2 plus the quarter period pi over 4. Multiply negative pi over 2 by 2 over 2 in order to get a common denominator. That's going to give us negative 2 pi over 4. And so this is equal to negative pi over 4. So that's the next point we'll mark on our x-axis. Then to find the x-coordinate of the next key point, we just take this x-coordinate, negative pi over 4, and add another quarter period to it. That's going to be 0. So right there, at x equals 0, that's where our next key point will be. Then, for the x-coordinate of the next key point, we take 0 and add another quarter period. That's going to be pi over 4. So we'll put that right about there. And then one more time, we take that x-coordinate, pi over 4, and add another quarter period to it. So that's going to be pi over 4 plus pi over 4, that's 2 pi over 4. And we'll put that right about there. And remember, there are 5 key points in a period of a sine or cosine function. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we've got 5 x-coordinates marked, we're good to go. So let's plot those points. This is a cosine function with a positive amplitude, so at the phase shift, the beginning of its period, it starts at its peak, which in this case is y equals 2. And then it goes down to the midline, and then down to its lowest point, and then back up to the midline, and then back up to its highest point, completing the period. And then we can sketch that period of the cosine function, looks something like that. And we could try sketching a little more, looks something like that. And then lastly, you'll probably want to go in and reduce those fractions. In this case, there is just one fraction to reduce, 2 pi over 4. We can reduce that to pi over 2. And there we go, there's our sketch of this cosine function. On to the next one. All right, here's a fun one, nice sine function. Go ahead and draw these axes. And in this case, I can see that there's no vertical shift at the end of the function, but I immediately see we have a phase shift of positive pi over 4. So I'm going to give us lots of room in the positive part of the x-axis. All right, what's our midline? Well, there's no vertical shift, so our midline is y equals 0. What about the amplitude a? Check to see if x is going to get multiplied by a negative number, and I see that it is not. So our amplitude is good as it is. That's negative 1.5. We don't have to mess around with any negatives. Now we can go ahead and mark the y-axis. Since our amplitude is negative 1.5, we want to mark on the y-axis 1.5 units above the midline and 1.5 units below the midline. In this case, that's 1.5 and negative 1.5. Next, what about the phase shift? Well, since x has a coefficient of 1 here, because this 1/2 has been factored out, we can immediately pick out our phase shift as pi over 4, which we already said earlier. Now, the period p. Well, that's going to be the typical period of a sine function divided by that 1/2, which is equal to 4 pi. Alright, so our period is getting stretched out. And remember, that's because x is going to have to change more to complete a whole period, because it's getting multiplied by that 1/2. Lastly, a quarter period, 4 pi over 4, that's going to be pi. Now in this case, since we have a phase shift of positive pi over 4, and we're going to sketch our period going forward from there, we're not going to cross the origin in our calculations. Oftentimes, we like to use the origin as a sort of reference point for establishing the scale of the x-axis. In this case, since we're not going to pass by it, it'll be helpful to use the end of our period as a reference point. To find where our period ends, we just have to add the phase shift to the period length. Multiply 4 pi by 4 over 4 to get common denominators. That's 16 pi over 4. So we can see our period that we're going to sketch will end at 17 pi over 4 on the x-axis. So put that wherever you would like your period to end. I'd like to have a good amount of room to draw it, so I'll put it pretty far out here. That's 17 pi over 4. Alright, and then we want to mark our phase shift on the x-axis. Pi over 4, the phase shift, is pretty darn small compared to 17 pi over 4, so pi over 4 should be pretty close to 0. Let's put it right about there. And that is our phase shift, pi over 4. And then what I think is the best way to do this when we're not passing by the origin is mark down halfway between the phase shift and where the period ends, right about there. That's the location of our third key point. Then, halfway between the phase shift and that third key point is the second key point. And halfway between the third and fifth key point, the fifth key point being the end of the period, that's right there, and that's the fourth key point. These are all delicate steps to make sure that we have a decently accurate sense of scale. And again, you can typically use the origin, or where your period ends, to get an idea of how far apart your marks on the x-axis should be. In this case, since we weren't going to pass through the origin, we used the end of the period. Alright, now we just have to do the calculations to see what the x-coordinates of these key points are. To find this one, we add a quarter period to the phase shift, so that's pi over 4 plus pi, but I know that pi is 4 pi over 4, so I'm just going to write it like that, and we see that is 5 pi over 4. So we'll label that here on the x-axis, that's the x-coordinate of our next key point. And I can easily see that each of these next key points is going to go up by another 4 pi over 4, that's another quarter period. So add 4 pi over 4 to that, that's 9 pi over 4, add 4 pi over 4 again, that's 13 pi over 4. And then you can check to make sure you've done this right, because if you add a quarter period to this, you should get the end of the period, which we do. 13 pi over 4 plus 4 pi over 4 is 17 pi over 4. Alright, we're closing in on the end game now. Now we can graph those key points. Sine function starts at the x-coordinate of our phase shift, and since it's a sine function, its y-coordinate is at the midline. Typically, the sine function goes up from there, but since it's getting multiplied by that negative number, it's going to go down instead. So instead of going up to its peak, it goes down to its lowest point, then back up to the midline, and then back up to its peak, and then back down to the midline to finish the period. Alright, and what I think is the most stressful part is actually sketching the function. There we go, something like that. That's a single period of this function, and of course we could sketch some more if we were so inclined. Remember as well that a typical sine function has a period of 2 pi, so a typical sine function would have completed a period right around there. So we can see how this function is really getting stretched out by that 1/2. Alright, next example. Is this the last one? No, it's not. Alright, I gotta keep on talking. Alright, but as it turns out, looks like this is a pretty easy one. So, we're good. We'll do it. Alright, we've got our axes we'll start off with. And I can see there's going to be some sort of phase shift, but because of the stupid way the function is written, I don't exactly know what it is. Not at a glance, anyways. First things first, what is our midline? Well, there's no vertical shift, so the midline is y equals 0. And then what about the amplitude a? Well, at this step is when I like to check the coefficient of x to see if it's positive or negative. I see that it's negative, I want to get rid of that, so let's do that. Inside the cosine function, we're going to factor out a negative 1. So we have negative x over 2 plus 2. And then because cosine is what's called an even function, cosine of that negative stuff is equal to cosine of that stuff without the negative. Beautiful. So let's go ahead and erase the original function and move up this equivalent one. Our amplitude for this function is negative 1. Typically, since amplitude is a distance, we think of the amplitude as always being positive. But in order to avoid being too long-winded, we're just calling that number in front of the function the amplitude, whether it's positive or negative. More formally, we might think of the amplitude as being the absolute value of that number. Alright, now let's go ahead and label our y-axis. The midline is 0, the amplitude's absolute value is 1, so we just have to mark 1 unit above y equals 0, and 1 unit below y equals 0. I always seem to put these lower marks a little bit too high, move it down just a little bit. Next, the phase shift. Notice that x actually is getting multiplied by 1/2 right now, so we can't just pick out the phase shift. So let's just go ahead and set the inside of the function, x over 2 plus 2, equal to 0. Then we can subtract 2 from both sides, so x over 2 equals minus 2, multiply both sides by 2, and we get that x equals negative 4. That's where cosine of 0 occurs, so that is our phase shift. I deliberately gave us a kind of ridiculous phase shift that you probably won't ever see for this problem. Just so you know, hey, the phase shift doesn't always have to be in terms of pi. But now, since I see that our phase shift is negative, I'm going to move around these axes just a little bit to give us more room on the negative part of the x-axis. Alright, now what is the period p? Well, it's 2 pi, the period of a normal cosine function, divided by the number getting multiplied by x. In this case, x is getting multiplied by 1/2, so that's 2 pi over 1/2, which is equal to 4 pi. And now, actually, I notice, since the period is 4 pi, which is quite a bit bigger than negative 4, our period is going to spend plenty of time in the positive portion of the x-axis. So I'm actually going to move these things back. This is the sort of stuff you gotta do when you're sketching these graphs, is be aware of where your graph is actually going to be. And based on that information, that can sort of influence how you draw the axes. Because you want your axes to facilitate you drawing the period that you're trying to draw. Now, to get some sense of how we want to scale the x-axis, let's do what we did before. We'll add the period and the phase shift. In this case, that's 4 pi plus negative 4, which is 4 pi minus 4. It might help you to factor a 4 out of that to get some idea what this number is. Pi minus 1, that's going to be a little bit more than 2, so multiply that by 4, it's going to be a bit more than 8. So since this is positive, obviously it needs to go over here, we want to put it wherever we would like our period to end. I'd be comfortable with it ending right about there, so that's what we will label as 4 times pi minus 1. Then we just got to do a little bit of approximating. Since, like we said earlier, this number is a little bit bigger than 8, halfway between the origin and this x-coordinate should be a little bit bigger than 4. So that same distance in the negative direction, maybe about there, that's a bit less than negative 4. so it might be negative 4.3 or something. Our phase shift, though, is negative 4, so that's going to be just a little bit closer to 0 than that number, so maybe right there. And again, that's because we said this mark is a little bit less than negative 4. Our phase shift is negative 4, so we want to get a little bit bigger, a little bit closer to 0. So we'll say this here is negative 4. You can see things get a bit annoying when we have a phase shift that isn't in terms of pi. Alright, now we'll do the same thing that we were doing in the previous example. Our third key point should be halfway between the phase shift and the end of the period. And maybe that's right about there. Then halfway between the first key point and the third key point is the second key point. So that's probably right around there. And then lastly, halfway between the third and the fifth is the fourth key point, right about there. Alright, now let's do the calculations. I forgot we never found our quarter period. That's just the period 4 pi divided by 4, which is pi. We had a similar example earlier. So to find the x-coordinate of that key point, we just take our phase shift, negative 4, and add a quarter period. So that's negative 4 plus pi, or pi minus 4. Let's zoom in to write that. Pi minus 4. And here, since we've made this mark close to 0, we should take note of this number and make sure that it actually is less than 0. Because we only put this mark here because it sort of looked like it was halfway between here and here. Indeed, since pi is a little bit more than 3, certainly less than 4, pi minus 4 is negative, so that's reasonable. Alright, and the next key point. We just have to take this x-coordinate, pi minus 4, and add pi to it. So pi minus 4 plus pi, that of course is equal to 2 pi minus 4. And we'll zoom in to write that as well. 2 pi minus 4. And then for the last key point, we'll stay zoomed in, move this a little over to give us some more room. We just have to add pi to that again. So that's pretty easy. That's 3 pi minus 4. All right, there we go. We've labeled the x-axis. Now we can graph the points and be on our way. This is a cosine function, so at the phase shift, it would typically start at its peak, but it's getting multiplied by a negative number, so that's going to get reflected across the y-axis, so it's going to start at its lowest point. Then it's pretty straightforward from there. At the next key point, it goes up to the midline, and then up to its peak, and then back down to the midline, and then back down to its lowest point. And then to sketch this, well, it's going to look something like that. And again, we could keep going on if we wanted to, sketch it a little roughly, or if we wanted to, we could find more key points. We just have to add more quarter periods to this x-coordinate, or subtract more quarter periods from this x-coordinate. And hey, that's not so bad. And you know what? This last example, I'll actually leave to you to try on your own. Grab a paper and pencil and give it a go, and yeah, this one looks pretty nasty, so consider it a challenge. You can see we've got that 1/3, so the period is going to be expanded by a factor of 3. And just keep applying the method that we used in this lesson to graph these functions. Find the midline and the amplitude, and make sure x has a positive coefficient while you're at it. Then you can label the y-axis. Then find your phase shift, and then find your period and quarter period. Then, based on where the period starts at the phase shift, and where it ends, which is the period plus the phase shift, you want to put some consideration into how you will draw the scale of the x-axis. Then you just got to do the computations. Phase shift plus quarter period gives you the next key point. Then add another quarter period for the next key point, and so on. Then you just plot your key points, and you sketch the graph. And of course, when you sketch the graph, you want to make sure to remember if your amplitude is positive or negative, because that will affect how you draw the graph. With all of that said, let me know how this nasty example goes in the comments. I'll leave some of the information about it in the description, so you can at least check if you've got the midline and period right and all that stuff. So I hope this video helped you understand how to graph transformations of sine and cosine. Let me know in the comments if you have any questions, need anything clarified, or have any other video requests. Thank you very much for watching, I'll see you next time, and be sure to subscribe for the swankiest math lessons on the internet. And a big thanks to Valo, who, upon my request, kindly gave me permission to use his music in my math lessons. Link to his music in the description.
She keeps the sunset on a string, watches from afar in the hall. stay.